So my title is Emission Inventories for Air Quality and Climate Modeling, so really the use of emission inventories. I'll tell you more about that later. Of course, what I show you is not just my work. I work together with a lot of people, a team in TNO, but also a lot of colleagues from other universities, other institutes in different projects. So I just grabbed everything together. It's not just my work, it's a lot of people collaborating. First of all, I'd like to tell you something about myself. Who am I? So I'm 55 years old. This is when I was much younger, as Nico just explained, when I was doing my PhD. And I like to show this picture because it partly explains why I'm here. So what you see in the back are the rice fields, the rice paddy fields. I was doing my research on climate change, really doing measurements of methane emissions from rice fields, with my feet in the mud, putting casings over them, taking gas samples, and really enjoying my time abroad very much. What you see here behind me is my girlfriend, later my wife, and one of my best friends, Rob, who they both came over to visit me there. But I stayed there for a longer time, and this period I really enjoyed very much, and this is one of the reasons why I really, if there was an opportunity, I would have liked to go away again. But after this, you can sort of guess what happens. The girlfriend became my wife, you get a child, you buy a house, you get another child, and traveling and going away for long time periods is not really possible. But like I said, it's 25 years ago, things change. This is my goodbye picture from Schiphol Airport. My youngest daughter, Zita, 16, my son, 19, Lona, Dido, the oldest, 22. My wife was away for the weekend. They said, don't worry, Dad, we will bring you. So that's what happens to if there's any young parents here. In the end, it all pays off. You take them everywhere, you bring them to school, you do everything. There comes an age when they say, oh, we will take you there, we will bring you. So it's really good. And so my visit here started, and that was brilliant, and not really a coincidence, but a brilliant timing, with an expert meeting on emission inventories, organized by the center here. This little arrow just to show that I was really there. And I also like to compliment you that you do this communication so well, because this is done, this was 2 weeks ago, it's on the website already. You have, I think it's very important, right? We do research, but if you do brilliant things in a little room and you don't tell anyone, that's pretty useless, especially if you do applied science like we do. So that's a very good start. Then where do I work? I work for TNO. TNO is an applied science institute, so we're not a university. We don't have students. We get students sometimes who do a master subject or something, but not that regularly. It's really an applied science institute, and we're sort of the intermediate. Officially, we were founded by law in 1932 or something, and the idea was to make science applicable for society and industry, and at that time, really also industry. We had a rubber institute, and we had a, I don't know, this has changed over time, but the idea is still pretty much the same. So, really developing of fundamental knowledge happens elsewhere, for example in universities, and we are there to take it up, to absorb it and to make it applicable for science, but mostly for society when you're talking about environmental sciences. But in TNO there's also an institute working on automotive, there's an institute working on optics, making sensors for satellites, that sort of thing. So it's about 3,000 people in total. We have institutes all over the country. This is not so interesting, but here this is interesting. You can see that actually this is the amount of work we do for companies. This is what we do for the government, and this is what we do in international. So actually, more than one third of it is really international projects, which is a lot of EU funded, EU cooperations type of work. And then there's different, like I said, there's really different teams and groups and institutes, and I work on environmental sciences. So we have four or five teams, and there's one here on emissions, models and simulation. That's really where I belong to. But we also have lab facilities, and I work with the lab every now and then if I have a project. I'm still, in my heart, an experimental scientist. I love to do measurements, and I think they are the reality check. So if I have a chance anywhere to promote measurements, I always do it, because we really need them. So that's the background for TNO, and some introduction. And then what I'd like to tell you about now is so a little bit on why and how we make inventories. And then a selection of topics, because there's a lot I could tell. There's too much, really, and maybe this is even too much, but I'll try. I'll touch upon greenhouse gases, not so much, but for us it's a new, something that's really high on the agenda, so I'd like to say something about it. And then I'll touch upon non-exhaust road transport, wood burning, a bit boring for some of you who have been in the workshop, because I will repeat myself there, but I still think that's one of the topics that could be really interesting here in Chile. Emission timing, and finally, we have some, hopefully some time for discussions. So to start with, I always like to really advocate emissions. Emissions is really key, and I'll tell you why. This is basically the framework that all my work, our work, centers around. It's this framework which has drivers, pressure, state, impacts and responses. So drivers are the economic activities. So you have, for example, agriculture, or you have a factory making something. That factory needs energy, it will burn fuels, and that results in emissions. And those emissions are the pressure on the environment. And that pressure changes the state. And the state is, for example, the air quality. So how much concentration of these pollutants you have. This is what you try to understand when you, the combination of sources and transport, when you do air quality modeling. You try to understand the state, or you start to try to predict the state. You say, okay, I know now I have a good system, this is how the weather will be, I will predict what the concentration will be in 2 days ahead, or something like that. So that pressure on the environment gives impacts, like can be health impacts, or it can be a loss of biodiversity, it could be different things. And if you don't accept that impact as a society or as a person, you want to formulate a response. So you make a policy, for example, you want cleaner cars. But the thing is that if you cannot directly influence the state, you will always have to go back either to the drivers, so you can forbid a certain activity. You can say, okay, we no longer want this kind of industry or thing to take place, but usually that's not the case, because it's also our economic income. We don't want to stop driving cars, or we don't want to stop producing goods, but we do want to make them, want to do it cleaner. So actually you go back to the emissions again. So that's why I always try to explain emissions are really key. They are here, the pressure on the environment, but if you want to do something about it, you usually also have to go back to this emissions information to formulate your So it's a long story about this picture, but it's actually really what it's all about, as far as I'm concerned. So why make this kind of emission inventories? This is an example. In Europe we have the Copernicus Atmospheric Monitoring Service. It also delivers services on a global scale. It's an interesting website to visit. You can go here and you can look for very different products. This is an example. I just picked it up this morning. So it's the weather forecast, the PM, so the chemical weather forecast, the PM forecast, in this case for Friday the 14th. So looking over Europe, Eastern weekend will be pretty clean this time. So that's something you can predict. So it's a good idea to go outside and do nice things. But to make that kind of predictions, air quality models need this emission input. And that's really one of the things we really have been working on. And again, we cannot stress it enough, you know, like any model, you know, garbage in is garbage out. So you need to get good input. And next to the meteorological data, the emissions are that kind of input. So, okay, I can convince you that emissions are necessary. But one of the key questions always is it okay? Is it really just administrative? Is it, you know, stacking things, like you can see from the images that I don't like this one very much, and I do like this one. So is it also science? And I'll try to tell you that, that it is also science, but not only. This is important. You need, for example, activity data, and that's statistics, and they need to be collected, and it's more like a task. You need to collect that data. You need to do that rigorously in a very dedicated format. It should always be the same, and so that's very important. Fortunately for me, there are other people doing that, and there are still people necessary who did this one, and I'll try to convince you. So if there's emission, it's activity times emission factor. So the emission factor measurement is a complicated thing. It's I would say that's scientific. How do you do that? How do you do that all the same? But once you have that, there's a lot of this involved. And if you look in Europe, that's really by law. Please have a seat. Plenty of them. In Europe, there's regulation on this. A country needs to, well, that's always in English in law, that the shall means you really shall. It's not a should means that would be nice if you do it, but if you don't, no worries. But here, it's shall. So Europe and Europe countries have to make an inventory, and they have to provide it to the European Union. And it is available to everyone. So you can take it and you can look at it. But that's not enough. And this is, you don't need to go and understand different European countries, but I'll just want to give you an example of why it's not enough. So we have different countries and they all submit their emission inventories. And I normalize the inventories here at saying the emission in the year 2000 is 1 for every different source sector. You can see trends. So you see some source sectors that go down. It's not important what they are. Some stay rather stable. This looks pretty plausible. This, of course, looks like a mess. And here, nothing was reported for that particular pollutant. And here, it goes all over the place, and I don't really know why. But that means, if you want to make a consistent map that you can use for this European air quality prediction, there's still quite a lot of checking, validating. That's the sort of thing we do with a relatively little team. So the big effort, I should stress that, is actually that these countries make all these data, collect all these statistics, make that product available. But after that, there is still an after treatment necessary, and that's where we come in. Then the other thing is that these emission inventories, they have to be delivered, but annual totals, not on a spatial scale, so not on a grid map, but just for a table that you can compare to another country maybe, or that you can negotiate. But for a model, or to be able to study, or do studies with it, you need it gridded. And that means that for every source sector, we choose a certain proxy. So road transport, we would allocate roads. Residential heating, you can allocate to population density. Point sources, they have a specific location. I'll talk about those in a minute. So for every one of these, we choose a certain proxy. Agricultural or animal husbandry, we will have maps from the FAO that give animal heads per square kilometer or something like that. So for everything, you can pick something, and that means you get a uniform map over Europe, and that's another advantage of the things we do. And it results in this kind of maps. So this is an example, just an example of the total NOx emission in 2009 over Europe. And you can recognize the shipping tracks, you can see the road network, and you can recognize the big urban centers in here. Point sources you don't see so well in here because it's a high resolution map, so it's like 7 by 7 kilometers every dot. So a point source would be only in one spot, so you wouldn't see it. It would only be one pixel, although the emission would be very high. So point sources you need to treat separately. You keep them on their exact location. And another thing with point sources, you have to look at them year by year because they are so important, they can change dramatically. This is an animation of the SO2 emissions from the power plants in Spain, and you can see that they're great reductions in emissions, but also that they're not always at the same time happening, and that's logical. You know, you have a factory, it implements a certain measure, but the neighboring power plant might do that next year or after 2 years. They don't all do it at the same time. So power plants and point sources, they really need special attention. And that's what we also try to do. And then you can look and see that there are sometimes really, you have this emission database, you can play with it. And here you see two examples for Spain, that's this one. And Poland, another one, and you see the SO2 emissions going down over time. You can see that here in Spain there's really an abrupt change. Now sometimes that would mean that there is an error, but you can also go back and look what's happening there. And here we saw that there was really policy being implemented. So from 1 year to another they really started no longer to burn dirty coal, and they really started to obey the European rules for low sulfur emissions. In Poland, you see a different strategy, and you see it's going gradually going down. So, countries do have different ways towards the same goal. Another nice thing, and that's maybe even more important, that with emission inventories, you can have a very quick idea of your key sources. So, what you see here are black carbon emissions for the Netherlands in the year 2009, and these are the source sectors. So, you can immediately see that in the Netherlands, if you want to do something about black carbon emissions, you need to address transport, road transport, and more specifically diesel. That's very clear. But if you take another country, also in Europe, and you look again at the black carbon emissions, in this case for Poland, you see the main source sector is actually residential combustion. They burn coal in households to heat houses. That's the main source there. So even for Europe, we have European legislation, but if you want to do something, really achieve something in different countries, you need different policies. You cannot, there's not one policy, not one size fits all. You have to think about that. And of course that's true even if you go down in scale. So also I guess here in Chile, if you would look to the south or the north, you want to reduce something, you need a different measure. Of course our countries are much smaller, so here you see it a little bit stretched, but the same story would apply to provinces.
It's also interesting to look at the scales. If you see road transport, it's almost the same height of the...
Yeah, but Poland is...
In terms of absolute balance.
But Poland is a much bigger country. So of course, if you have to express it then per inhabitant, it would look different again. But also there is a lag in technology. So Poland is more Eastern Europe, it's still catching up in terms of... That's true. But I just like to, you know, that's the European case, but I just like to say that you really can identify key sources and you can identify which sector to address. And that's much better than trying to do things in, let's say, alphabetical order and say, okay, we're going to do something about our air pollution. We start with all sources that start with an A or something.
So the difference between coals and fine?
Yeah, that was because so this is the blue is everything in the size PM2.5, and the coarse is in 2.5 to 10, and actually that's mostly not combustion emission, but that's mostly like, for example, coal, fine coal dust that's being, you know, you have the loading of coal and so you get dust. But we try to understand if there would be a substantial coarse fraction also. So, having that as a background, so we have these emission maps, we have these emission databases, and so on. I jump to some other things. And the fun thing is for me now that, like I showed you this slide from 25 years ago, I was there in the wetland rice fields doing climate research. Over the past 10, 15 years, I've been mainly working on air pollution and air quality. That's what where the money went also for substantial research in Europe. Now it's changing again, and climate change is very much on the agenda again, on the research agenda. It doesn't mean that air quality is no longer seen as important, but it has shifted from research to implementation. So there's more money going to implementing measures and less to researching what is actually the causes and so on. So for me, one of the things I now look into with a lot of other people is what would that mean if there is, if this is more on the agenda again. And the reason why it's on the agenda is, of course, the COP21. It didn't happen because we thought about it and said it's important. This is really what pushed policymakers in Europe to rethink this, and governments like it, and they say we can be proactive here. We can show ourselves that they like this thing. So that's behind it. I don't mind because I think it's a big problem. So for me, it's good, and I can think about it again. And what thing I think is really, and that's I do a lot of things on this. We do measurements of methane on landfills and monitoring in cities, but that I will not touch upon that. What I'd like to say is that what I think is the most important at the moment. So climate change is a very complex problem, but if you zoom out, it actually becomes pretty straightforward again. What you see here, CO2 is the most important greenhouse gas. And what you see here are the top five emitting countries in the European Union and their CO2 emissions. So you immediately, if you look at this graph from 1990 to 2014, you see a few remarkable things. One, the most important, is China, which has over a very short time period grown rapidly and is actually already more than two times the emission of the US. That's incredible in what kind of short time step that happened. And the strange thing about climate change is that we know what it's about. So we know CO2 is the most important greenhouse gas. We know we should reduce it. So why do any research? You know already what to do. And that's, of course, because it's so complicated politically. It's about economy. It's about who will pay the price for not burning those fuels or for changing to renewable fuels. What you see also is that the European Union here is sort of stable, leveling off a little bit. But from this graph, you can at least immediately see, I can immediately see, that Europe is not going to make a big impact here. If we are reducing our share with, you know, even if we would reduce it to 10%, this whole total would not be influenced. It's a global problem, and we need everyone to work on this.
Well, yes. Wondering if we can really label the emissions to each country, because China is producing that amount of CO2 emissions for products for other countries.
You can, and I'll show you another slide in a minute. It's not, the last thing I'm trying to say is that we should blame China.
Yeah.
I'm just saying this is a global problem, and even if we would cocoon in Europe, we would not be able to solve that. You know, for air quality it's different. You know, you can do a lot in a rather local domain. You still have exchange from far away, but this is really different. And one thing that I'd like to show, which I think is very important, in this graph, if you look closely, this is India, and actually India is trying to pick up the trend that we saw here with China. So that's quite it's intriguing, it's also very worrying. If they go the same way, we're really in big trouble globally. So not so to blame India or China, because the next slide is, if you look at tons per CO2 per capita, it's of course still the US is the top emitter and India is really down here. So really it's not about blaming other countries, just saying it's a global problem and you need to address it globally. Why is it so difficult to do it? It's also because even if I look at myself, I think climate change is a real issue and I think we need to do something about it. But to grasp the concept that maybe 50 or 80 years later, so not in my lifetime, I will not live to see it, someone else on the other side of the globe, so probably not even my family or my kids, will have a big problem, and therefore I need to do something drastically now, that you cannot really do it. So I'm willing to do some things, I'm willing to pay a little bit more for my energy, I'm willing to whatever, separate my trash or something like that, but dramatic changes like no more flying, becoming vegetarian, that's difficult. So the point is that you cannot expect that people will solve it by themselves. Some people say, you know, start small, you have to do it yourself, you can change it. I like the positive message of that, but on the other hand, I think you really need to see that this needs to be asked for governments and leadership on a much bigger level. And to support that, is what I've been working on recently, and there's a CO2 report out. We call it the CO2 report. It's towards an operational observation system to monitor fossil CO2 emissions. So it's about how could you use satellites to actually monitor the emissions from states and give them information that they can actually really independently discuss and debate what is happening. Because what is happening at the moment, and we see that in Europe, even my prime minister says, no, I will not close our coal-fired power plants, because if I do that, the Polish will quickly open a new one. It's really about, you know, blaming and being very conservative. And this, I hope, and we think, could change if there would be really out in the open pictures showing this is what you contribute, this is how it, why it's going on. That's a really a roadmap. So we think actually this will not happen in the next 10 years, but we hope to build it up in the next 10 to 15 years, and then maybe in 2013 you could have such a system. And it combines everything, of course, inverse modeling, new satellites and sensors, but also again the emissions and the bottom-up emissions data, so we can play a role there. So if you that report is really very compact, it's only 80 pages, it has some top people contributing to it. I really like it, so if you're interested in that topic, look at it. Why am I so optimistic that something like this could really be true? This is what some of my Dutch space colleagues made for me, this slide. It shows three satellites, Kiamaki, COSAT and the TROP-OMI satellite, which is to be launched in July 2017, hopefully. And if you just look at the footprint, the Kiamaki had 60 by 30 pixels, so 1800 square kilometers. TROP-OMI will have 50. And the biggest, I don't know, the nicest way to immediately see what this will bring is to look at the cloud-free coverage for a month in September. So this is from the GOSAT. And this is a simulation of what the TROP-OMI should bring. And you don't need to have knowledge about satellites, or I don't even have knowledge about satellites, but you can immediately see the difference in the resolution and in the coverage. And even, yes, there's problems over the tropical rainforest with clouds always, but it's easy to understand that if your pixel size decreases a lot, then the chances that there is a cloud in that pixel is much smaller. So you have these big pixels, and there's a cloud here, then that means the pixel is no longer cloud free. But if you have a lot of these pixels, then that cloud there doesn't affect all these pixels. And it has a big impact. So with this satellite, for example, we'll be able to see methane. So we're going to use it to look at point sources of methane for oil and gas, for example. But the idea is that in the future we should have something for CO2 like that as well. And that would be marvelous. So that's what we try to push for greenhouse gases very much. I think in general, Earth observation data, satellite data is a great opportunity. They have been really overselling it. The people who made the satellites, they said satellites will solve everything. We don't need bottom-up inventories anymore. We will solve everything. Of course, that was a painful mistake. It's just everybody always has a, and I'm probably every now and then the same if I want to get money and say I will do this brilliant thing. So I don't blame them too much, but already in the 90s they promised to really, you know, solve any emission problem. But having said all that, I think now it's really starting to pay off. And so it took longer, but it's getting there, and there's a lot of opportunities in there. I won't talk much about it, but if you're interested, I'm happy to explain more about what we do at the moment with satellite data. Instead, I'd like to move back to air pollution. And for me, some of the substances like NOx or SO2, they're not so interesting from the emission inventory point of view. There's still enough to tackle, but PM is really a different animal. And it is so complex because it comes from combustions, it comes from activities like driving around or plowing your field. It has so many different sources, and also the characteristics. It's not, this thing, this can be mineral, it can be organic, it can be heavy metals, it can be anything. So it's a great puzzle. And just to go really back, so this is from a paper in 2007, when we actually were asked to make an emission inventory for heavy metals. And one of the heavy metals we we're looking at was copper. And I always work in this sequence. So I make this inventory, I give it to a model. The model calculates the concentrations and the deposition. We look at measurement data and we see, does it make sense? And for copper, we found out we did a horrible job. It was terrible. Very bad correlation, really located at the wrong spots, and big underestimation. And then one of my colleagues said, well, you know, I've been making this inventory for water, and there we saw actually that the runoff from roads is really important. So we started to rethink and said, oh, so we came up that actually brake wear, so if you brake, your brakes are made of metal. And this was not in our inventories. We simply overlooked it. Why? Because in the 1990s we still had asbestos brakes. So then it was not in our metal inventory. Then, due to policies, asbestos is really bad for you, they changed it. Much of the brake pad material now is metals. But we never really made that connection in the inventory, so we didn't show it. So we started to collect data, measurement data first. So you see here, two countries, Switzerland and Netherlands, in the really rural, coastal or rural background, to the curb of the street. And you see a very strong increase of the amount of copper in that you observe there. So that really helped us to convince, yes, there must be something with traffic. And this is not exhaust, this is wear. So this is the brake wear. At the same time, there was another very interesting study in the US. This guy did marvelous work. So this, what he did is, you have this car here, those are the state troopers. And these guys, they sit with their window open, you've seen them in the movies, next to the road. They actually spent 8 to 10 hours a day next to the road. And what they did is they measured the PM concentrations and the chemical speciation inside those cars. And there's a lot more to tell about it, but what actually came out is that these guys are healthy young men, they have problems. They have cardiovascular problems, sleeping, heart rhythm problems, and it was related to the metals that they could find inside their car. So it's a brilliant study. And why am I telling you this? Because for us, it is still very much on our radar, because this is the trend in road transport PM emissions. So this is primary PM, so it's not the secondary inorganic that forms from the NOx and so on, just the impact of the primary. So this is exhaust in the 1990s, and this is where we are now. Because of all the diesel particulate filters, new engine technology. If you look at the non-exhaust, we didn't do anything about it, because we also don't really know how. It's about tire wear, it's about brake wear, it's difficult. But by now, instead of being just 10% of the total, it's actually more than 50%. So this is now our dominant primary source of road transport PM emissions. And we need to think about what to do about that. And because these metals, you know, one of the things about particulate matter is that what we do now in health studies, we assume all particles are equal. So you have an exposure to PM, but actually I'm pretty much convinced that some particles are more equal than others, and that particles that contain heavy metals or carcinogenic polycyclic aromatic aromates are more dangerous than some of the others. It's difficult to prove it though. But if that's the case, then this wear emission with all its copper and iron in very small fine fractions could be really important. If you'd like to know more about it, there were two consecutive workshops, and this included people like epidemiologists, people who do measurements, people who do modeling, people who work on emissions inventory sites, and there were two consecutive workshops. So this one is the latest one. It was 2 years after the first one, and they give a very nice wrap-up of how these people, from toxicologists to air quality modelers, look at this topic. So if you're interested, have a look at those. They give a nice overview. Then we jump to my next hobby, which is wood combustion. So we have again such a map as I've shown you in the beginning, and this shows you the organic carbon in particulate matter in 2.5 over Europe. And you can see that wood combustion and transport, they dominate here. Again, we give this map, this data to a modeler. We ask them to look at the concentrations and to look at what is, how well do we do. There were some sites where we had really good results, but it's also much more interesting to go where it is really bad, but that's where you can learn something. And this is a site in Sweden, south of Sweden. This is the observations, and this is the PM ChemX model. So I always work with different modelers. You know, we have our own model in TNO, but that is not important. There's people doing Chimere, there's people doing ChemX, CMAC, you know, for always as an emission person, you can work with everyone. It's very nice. But okay, back to it. Here, there's a big problem. This can't be right. And this is a site in South Sweden. No big city, hardly any traffic. It's winter. We know there's wood combustion. There can only be one source there that we basically do not get right. So we started to look into there and. I'm trying to keep it a little bit short, but what is important is that in this, what we call the Yukari inventory, that was the map I just showed you, what we did there, emission factors for wood burning are difficult. And you are already happy if you have PM emission factors, but to also have OC, or organic carbon, or elemental carbon emission factors, that's much more scarce, and it's tricky, and they can be very different. And so what we did, we said, okay, let's focus on the PM, and then we used the fraction in the PM to estimate the elemental carbon and the organic carbon. So that's what we did. So we took up the PM inventory from Norway, and we took up the PM inventory from Sweden, and we actually separated it into these different carbonaceous fractions using this fraction. But then you see what happens. So you have Norway, but the fun, or actually the strange thing is, these countries, they have the same climate. They're next to each other, they have pretty much the same culture. But Sweden has much more people, and it also uses a lot more wood. So how come the Swedish emissions are so low and the Norwegians are so high? And then we started to really dig deeper, and we found out that these two countries, they do a wonderful job. They're excellent people. They describe everything perfectly. They follow a protocol, just very different protocols. And the Swedish, they measure filterable PM, but total PM consists of two fractions, filterable PM and condensable PM. Filterable PM is solid, solid or liquid, it's captured on a filter, and it can be PM10 or it can be PM2.5. What you do is you measure the air that's immediately coming out of the chimney. So this is hot air, it's maybe 300 degrees, that's what you sample. All your black carbon or your elemental carbon will be in this filterable, because it's not volatile, it will be a particle. But the organic fraction is here. And there, that's what the Norwegians do. They measure this plus this, and they actually cool and dilute the sample, and then they analyze it. So you get, both measurements are actually right, and you can defend both approaches. It's not that you do something wrong, it's just apples and oranges. It's incomparable, it gives a completely different result. So then we said we need to go back. So let's go to the activity data and make a new selection of emission factors and try to make a complete independent bottom-up inventory that could be comparable. And this was our result. So you see, actually the Swedish inventory went really up, mostly because we added a lot of organic carbon, because they actually only represented the filterable PM. The Norwegians, they used a rather extreme dilution. And we opted for something that was more in the middle. So rather strange, they actually, this one went down, this one went up, they're now sort of equal. The reason why they are equal is because the appliance types are different. So Sweden has more people, bigger cities, and there's more of bigger boilers that warm a whole neighborhood, for example. Whereas Norway is more spread out, more individual stoves. So relatively, per unit of wood, they have a little bit more pollution. But we give that back to the modelers again, and this is a levoglucosan, the red one, that's a marker for wood combustion. You can actually, and you can see that the model now started to really reproduce much better. And if we looked over Europe, so we used the EMAP model from it was a collaboration with David Simpson, And we looked at different locations over Europe. So this is Finland, and you see the old run, and you see the new run. It's actually improving a lot. We're much closer to the one-by-one line. There's enough problems to solve, but it's a big improvement. If you look at a site in Germany, Melpitz, for you it's very far away, but it's a terrible, difficult site always to model properly. And you look at the new result, again, it's much better. So this really gives us the idea that we didn't solve it completely, but we're really on the right track. We need to do this. And we need to put this into the emission inventories, and we need to discuss this. Why is it a big issue? Well, primary PM is actually something that is very health relevant, and there's negotiations between countries that in Europe that they have to make achievements to lower their emissions because it's transboundary air pollution. And if you add what we have cooked up now, you have suddenly 60% more PM2.5, and that's like a hot potato for policymakers. They don't really like this. So. Or at least they need time to adjust to it. So there's now quite a debate on how should we do this. Some people say, well, you know, it should be solved in the model. So if we all only measure the filterable and then the model adds the condensable, that would be the way to do it. I don't like that for many reasons. One of is that the appliance type, so the stove type, is really important, and a model can never know this. You need to go to the inventories to do that. The other reason is that you also want to know cost efficiency of your measure. And if you try to replace stoves, for example, you would only see that in your emission inventory, and you wouldn't really see it in your model. So, but it's an open debate, and I don't know what will happen, because there's also people who say, no, we should solve it with the models and keep it out of the emission inventories. My last, I know I'm really putting quite a lot on you, but I'd like to show this because we have been talking also with Nicolas, and I think this is something we could also be working on here a lot. This is about emission timing. What you see here are the fireworks in the Netherlands for New Year. So that's only one moment in time in the year, and there's lots of fireworks going on. So January 1 is always the day with the worst air quality in the Netherlands. You can imagine that if you want to be able to understand that and predict that, you need to put all those fireworks emissions on the right moment. Now, is that not so difficult because it's always with New Year? But before, we just had it spread out over the whole year. It was in the PM inventory, but it didn't have a special, because it was not a special source. It was not New Year fire emissions. It's not like the you have road transport, and that was not the case. So it was somewhere hidden in the other things, and it was just spread out. And of course, the models always gave a very bad fit for the prediction for the 1st of January, and we knew real data from a Dutch company on gas delivery. So when do people actually use the gas for heating? And you see that our prediction was actually pretty good. We were really impressed. It works. So then we started to apply it over time to this case for Spain. So what you see here, the blue one is our default profile. And the green and the red are actually when we try to apply this degree day approach, as we call it. And you see that it's not so bad, actually, how it follows the default approach. But there are episodes where it's really missing. So on an annual average, if you want to model the annual average, it's not so important. You can work pretty well with the default approach. If you want to understand an episode, you really need this. And this is where we do this for years, so 2003, 2005, 2006, 2004. And you can see everywhere there are moments where it really is different. But it's never the same moment because, there are some predictions, you know, it's usually autumn or spring that's either cooler or warmer. It's never so that it suddenly freezes in summer or that it suddenly 20 degrees in winter. But this time you see it here. You see it there. It can be really, really different. So the episodes can be dramatically different. And to end, so what if you look at emissions and you look at emission science and how this is advocated also, for example, if you go to guidelines, you have two different things. You have validation and verification. And the validation is very much on, did you properly do everything? Did you follow the same rules as the other guy? And so on. It's important. I don't do much with it. I'm more here. I'm interested in the verification. So if you have this emission, and you have measurements, and you have models, can you verify that it's true? And if not, can you go back and improve again? And that's, I think, to summarize, yes, emissions can really be fun science.